everyone is in the cloud, getting into the cloud, and in some cases even getting out of the cloud. In this video, I explain in simple terms how applications run, what does it mean to be in the cloud, and the number of technologies involved in the process. So let's start. Imagine you are a professional cook. You want to make a dish with some ingredients. Most likely, you buy them directly from the supermarket and not harvest or manufacture them yourself. The way computers work is that there's some hardware, which is the physical stuff, and on top of that hardware, there's an operating system that is able to control this hardware and provide a simpler interface for all other applications. The operating system makes sure of allocating resources, grant access to the hardware, and prevent applications from misbehaving, among other things. All applications then run as a process or a number of processes. A process is an instance of a computer program. In our example, a process is like a recipe. Then a process will be similar to you cooking, following the recipe. When you're running a process in an operating system, you rely on certain utilities provided by the specific operating system, version, and even some libraries. A software engineer will develop an application locally on their desktop with this configuration. When running in a different machine, like the server, there might be different configurations, like libraries or versions that could introduce variants in the software, causing some bugs or affecting other applications running in the server. Imagine trying to cook the same recipe in different parts of the world. The ingredients will be a little bit different, so the flavor won't be the same everywhere. And while this is good for the cuisine world, it's not for software development. Additionally, different applications may run a different number of processes or have different resource requirements like a memory, CPU, or disk. So even if you manage to get exactly the same environment, all applications running next to each other might still cause some issues. It's like sharing a kitchen with other cooks to save costs. And you all get the ingredients from the same supermarket. They may use ingredients that you had planned for your dish, so you may run out of ingredients. Virtual machines are a simulation of a physical machine in an isolated way. Each virtual machine acts as an independent instance, running its operating system, providing isolation to applications, allowing them to run with the exact same configuration everywhere, and adjusting the number of resources they require. This separation ensures that applications don't interfere with each other, providing a more robust environment. In virtual machines, the hypervisor manages the virtual machines and allocates resources to them. Virtual machines provide isolation, security, and flexibility, but they also come with some overhead due to running separate operating systems for each virtual machine. Virtual machines really help getting the resources of a machine better utilized because you could split the resources of a big machine into smaller virtual ones. In our kitchen example, this would be like renting a building with other cooks where each one has its own kitchen next to each other and each having its own mini market to get ingredients from. And this mini market is provisioned from a bigger one close by. Now imagine, instead of having a supermarket each, you can have just a box where you put the needed ingredients and no one else uses them. Also means that you cannot take anyone else's ingredients. In the first decade of the 2000s, the Linux operating system introduced a couple of features called C groups and namespaces. These features allow the operating system to be completely sure that any process won't be able to take more resources than originally assigned to, like CPU, memory, disk, or even other resources like networking, and that each process will run in a completely isolated way from the other ones. This opened the door to containers. Containers are lightweight, portable, and platform independent, and have become one of the cornerstones of modern software application development. It includes all the code and dependencies. In comparison to VMs, you can run all containers with a single operating system. Even though containers can be stateful and mutable, as a best practice, containerized applications should be stateless and immutable. This is one of the best selling points for container-based infrastructures. This allows you to automate deployments and increase their frequency and their reliability. In the cooking example, this means that every time you're going to cook, you will receive a new box of all the ingredients that you need. All unused ingredients after the cooking session will be thrown away. You are still renting the kitchen. Depending on the week, you may have only one day of cooking, or maybe multiple days. Maybe during the weekend or on a special occasion, you need a bigger kitchen. In the container world, you will still need to either rent a kitchen for all purposes or personally take care of booking different kitchen and boxes for every week. Very time consuming. What if you could just specify the agenda, kitchen, and ingredient boxes configurations and make someone else take care of booking them? Welcome to Kubernetes. Container orchestration tools like Kubernetes allows you to deploy, run, and monitor applications running in containers. In Kubernetes, the isolation unit is a pod. You can have one or more containers running in a pod, and Kubernetes will make sure it behaves correctly with other containers in a cluster. But Kubernetes does more than that. It's a framework that allows you to expand additional responsibilities outside the pod. Kubernetes is composed of the control plane components, responsible for controlling the cluster and making global decisions like scheduling. The node components, the Kubernetes runtime on each of the nodes that allows you to run the pods. And add-ons, additional components that implement cluster features. These are also called resources. Before, when you managed your server, you had to make sure things like security, networking, and monitoring were properly configured. In Kubernetes, all of this is needed as well, and is able to run in a pluggable way. All of these are implemented as resources and provide features around an application like exposing the service to the network, providing configuration and secrets, access to persistent disk, monitoring, and more. So when you deploy your application to Kubernetes, you can configure the infrastructure around it as well. These resources are configured in YAML files, so a single application in Kubernetes can end up having many YAML files to run in a production state. A proper meal is not just cooking the ingredients. There are more things, multiple dishes, special tools to be used to prepare each dish, the place to serve and present them, and maybe special add-ons. This can grow in complexity very easily, so deploying an application is not just deploying the containerized application. It also includes the infrastructure around it. One way to simplify this is by the use of package managers. The most popular package managers are Helm and Kustomize. In Helm, for example, you can write a template with all the resources that need to be generated whenever you deploy a new application based on certain conditions. Packages generated using Helm are called charts. I have mentioned several cloud-native technologies today, and I hope I have demystified them for you. There are additional newer paradigms like serverless or function as a service, and even some emerging technologies like Kubernetes for IoT or virtualized Kubernetes inside Kubernetes clusters. But this starts feeling like inception, and I'm running out of kitchen examples. So let's just stop here. As you can see, there are different ways that applications can be deployed and how it has been changing through time. All of these approaches are still in use today for different reasons, from legacy to pragmatism or cost, though most modern architectures today are using the container-based approach. Don't forget to check the description for the links to resources, and if you have any questions or comments, just please let me know in the comment section below. I'll read you. Bye.